Good morning, welcome back once again. Today we're going to finish our discussion of the functional quantization of the scalar field. So if you recall how last lecture ended, we noticed that when you compute time-ordered correlation functions like this, for the quantum scalar field, we noticed that these correlation functions could be, you could think of them as being just a kind of generalized correlation function for a discrete Gaussian integral. This was something that we noticed in the previous lecture. So we found that this was, according to Wick's theorem, and in particular the two-point function, for the Klein-Gordon field, had a very striking resemblance to how you calculate two-point functions for discrete many-variable Gaussian integrals. So we have this, you know, with this result here, which we've already achieved by taking a functional integral, discretizing it, evaluating it, and taking the continuum limit, we're pretty satisfied with this one here. And indeed, in the exercises, you'll do the more general case according to this discretizing, evaluating, and taking the continuum limit recipe. But it turns out there's a much more elegant way, a supremely elegant way to get the same result without having to do the discretizing and so on. Now, it's important for you to, however, already to do this hard work so that you can then believe the continuum result. And so the result I want to show you today, the first part of this lecture, the result is a continuum analog of something you know very well from many variable Gaussian integrals. So here's something you know rather well. Okay, we proved this several lectures ago now. And remember in the end of the last lecture, I said the Klein-Gordon operator is sort of analogous to this matrix A, and that D, the Feynman propagator, is sort of analogous to the inverse of A. So this is how I ended the last lecture. Now, it turns out that that sort of analogy can be made sort of somewhat more precise and clearer. You know, here you just notice this as a kind of analogy. Well, it turns out there's a way to carry out these endpoint functions here in the continuum for path integrals using a formalism known as functional derivatives and generating functionals. So if you recall how we actually computed this result, we used the generating function. That was one way you can actually compute this result. And that's the object we're going to generalize today, these. So when you have a many variable Gaussian integral, you can set up this generating function, blah, 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 minus a half x transpose a x minus j transpose x. And then by differentiating this generating function at j is 0, you can bring down as many x's as you like and then be able to compute two-point functions or endpoint functions like that. So this is the object we want to generalize. This was such a useful object in the many variable Gaussian integral case that if we can generalize it, then by all means, let's try. And indeed we can, and I'll show you how to. And if you recall, the result you get for Gaussian integrals is this one here. And I think there's a factor of a half there. Yo, a question? At a to the minus one, thank you. Is there a factor of a half? I guess so, yeah. Yeah, I think there's a factor of a half. Good. So this is the object. This is like one of my favorite results for Gaussian integrals, that you can compute all these endpoint correlation functions by just differentiating this generating function. And if this analogy works out, then over here you might think, well, maybe there's a continuum version of this story. And indeed there is. So this is today's objective. Good. But first, functional derivatives. What are they? I'm going to define these things by example. You can actually make most of this, what I'm about to say, completely rigorous with functional derivatives. I mean, it belongs to the calculus of variations, and it's something that you've probably seen several times before. And I'm not going to spend too much time dancing around the rigorous parts of this theory. We only need just some basic calculational tools, and then I just leave it to you to research how to make it all concrete and well-defined. That's your job. So here we define, if you like, the functional derivative by the following equation. So this thing here, this delta delta j, this is the functional derivative here. So we introduce this thing eats a function and hands you back, well, maybe not a function, a generalized function. And this is like the continuum analog of something that's much more familiar. So I'll write out that much more familiar thing now, and then I hope you will agree this isn't such a ridiculous definition. So if you discretize j of x into just a bunch of variables, go with k, so we can always discretize a function of a continuous function into just a list of numbers. sorry, into a list of numbers. So the picture that you should always keep in mind here is that you have this, here's J, and then when you discretize J of X, then you just, what do you get? Well, you get a list of numbers. This is X1, this is X2, this is X3, blah, blah, blah. So discretizing a function just gives you a list of independent variables, x1 through to x whatever, infinity. Now, suppose we want to vary one of these variables and leave the others constant. And that's differentiation. So you have some function of all these variables and you differentiate that function with respect to, say, x4. That's a perfectly well-defined operation in standard calculus. So, for example, you might want to do just note that, you know, if you do a partial derivative with respect to one of these variables defining the discrete version of J, well, then we know what the answer is. If I differentiate the variable xj with respect to xk, then I just get either 1 or 0, depending on if I have a j equal to k or not. You can extend that to functions of these variables. It's not too complicated. Many variable calculus shows us that if we vary one variable, then the function we get afterwards is the partial derivative of that function. Now, this is the discrete analog of that expression there. So, you know, on one hand, on the left-hand side of a table, you could write down continuous, or why don't I write down that table? Continuous side, we have x, element of, say, the real numbers. And on discrete side, we have j, this index, which is element of the integers. Discretize. We have j of x, which is also an element of the real numbers, but it's also a function, right? So you should think of j of x as a function, so that's, maybe it's an element of some, let's make it some continuous function space. Some continuous function. And then on the discrete side, we have these xj's. X is perhaps an unfortunate choice here, but it's not that difficult to interpret what I mean here. Like, I could have just said jj, right? I'm discretizing a function at site j. So I'll leave it at that. Trust that you can make the appropriate modifications in what I just said. And then you've got, what else can we have here? So yeah, we've got the functional derivative. This is the thing that I'm sort of currently defining. And you've got some function of function, f. And the discrete analog is just d, d, j, little j, f of, well, x1. Sorry, J1, J2, just some mini variable function like that. So there's this nice one-to-one mapping between continuous concepts and discrete concepts. So this is, oh, this by the way, is an element of some vector space, right? So it's complex numbers. Or, yeah, I guess that's a slightly bogulating symbol. Let's just go with L2. Good. Now, we're doing all this because we're going to anticipate that we're going to be able to compute generating functions, and then we'll be able to compute correlation functions by differentiation. So we have to make a kind of continuous version of every piece of this identity here. So we're getting step one. But before I do that, I want to tell you a little bit more about how to work with functional derivatives. There's a couple of, issues to be aware of when working with functional derivatives. And these issues just have to do with the fact that here on the right-hand side, we've got this delta function, this Dirac delta function. So you have to be a little bit careful about the kinds of objects you're going to allow and how you work with them. So how do we work with functional derivatives in practice? How do we work with functional derivatives? So I'll just do some example computations. So the moral is follow the usual rules for derivatives. And if you consult the table we wrote that I erased, then you will see that well, you can look on the video to fill out your notes. Sorry about that. If you consult the table that I just erased, then you'll see that the functional derivative is just like the standard many variable derivative. So all the rules that the many variable derivative obey presumably transfer to the functional derivative. That's indeed the case. So let's give an example. This is a fairly complicated example and one that I think illustrates everything we're going to need with the functional derivative. So suppose you are wanting to compute the functional derivative of the exponential of some function of j of y and some other function phi of y. What does this equal? So exponential. So what? Let's just check that what we've got here on the right-hand side is something that the functional derivative can eat. So what we've got is the integral of a function and another function. That makes a number. So we have e to the I of some number that depends on a function j. That's something that this object can eat. So let's see what happens. So you just follow the rules for the normal derivative. Pretend that j is just a standard variable. Differentiate the exponential. So we know how to differentiate exponentials. And without I guess I'll do all the steps. Rather than just write out the answer. So the derivative of the exponential is the exponential. Right? So that goes unchanged. Multiplied, so we use the chain rule as you normally would for a derivative. So we have this. And then we have an I out the front. In this course, you're always allowed to move a derivative under an integral sign. So in it goes. So the derivative, the functional derivative of j with respect to jx is a delta function, right? That's how it works. And we're done, because that integral there we can do. So that computation is about as difficult as any computation we're ever going to need to do with functional derivatives. So they're only slightly more complicated than this. So I think that example is sufficient. But there's one subtlety, right? And that's to do with the fact that sometimes you're going to end up with derivatives of delta functions. So what to do with them? So I'll give another example, and then we're... What do we do when we encounter a functional derivative of something with a derivative on it? So for example, this is the kind of expression that can occur in practice. You could really want to compute the functional derivative of this thing. And you could see that if you move that functional derivative past the integral, apply it to the j inside the integral, that you're going to get a delta function, but you're going to get derivatives of delta functions. All right, what to do with those? Argument one is that derivatives of delta functions are actually generalized functions, and there's nothing really wrong with that. We know how to deal with those. Another argument is what you always do with these things is you just integrate by parts first. So that's the moral. If you've got a derivative on something you're about to differentiate, integrate by parts first. Integrate by parts, we get minus the integral where the derivative is now on the other thing, and a boundary term which basically is always zero except in really fascinating and cool topological theories, which we won't have in this course. And then we can do the functional derivative as before, and we end up with this very nice expression plus, well, zero usually. Good. I think that's just about enough on the functional derivatives. You can knock yourselves out with more complicated examples, but these two are about as difficult as we're ever going to need.
Yep.
Oh, should this, yeah, the question is, should this be an X? And indeed, it should be an X. Otherwise, things don't make sense. Thank you. That is an X. Fun and games can begin. This is what it's all for. All of this trouble we went to define these functional derivatives will pay off when we compute the following object. So this is obviously a useful thing. Why is it obviously a useful thing? Because correlation functions are directly related to derivatives of this object. There's an I outside of everything, so there's a minus here. This is, and I forgot the limit. If you can compute this object as a function of J, then you've got all the endpoint functions for your field theory. And you get them by functional derivatives of this thing and evaluating at J equals zero. So that, you know, when you see an expression like that, and you know about many variable Gaussian integrals, you know, hope springs that maybe this is really an easy way to get at all the endpoint correlation functions. And you'd be right. You don't have to discretize, you don't have to evaluate, you just have to know the generating functional as a function of J. And once you've got it, then you've solved your Gaussian theory, and you can use that then to work out interacting theories. So very exciting. So, of course, you can't always evaluate this expression, especially for interacting theory. So when this action here is including nonlinear terms, then if you could evaluate Z of J, you've solved the theory. I mean, that's as much power. It's as much power as you could ever have. So it's too much to hope that you can actually evaluate this generating functional for arbitrary field theories. But I tell you what, you can go a long way with just knowing it for free theories, and that's one we can do. All right, for free theories, the action is quadratic. And that, you know, that looks so much like a Gaussian integral, a generating function for a Gaussian, that it's just crying out to be solved. And we can do it. We're going to do this now. So let's look at the exponent in this generating functional. What does it look like for a free theory? Well, this very nice quadratic function here. Now I've already put in this factor I epsilon from doing the limit here. Isn't there an I missing? Yeah, there is an I missing, thank you. Yeah. And then, right, well, we have another term here, which is J, X. Phi x. That's the exponent of this path integral for the generating function. Now, how do we solve Gaussian integrals? Well, I made you do it back in lectures 1 or 2, and also on the exercise sheets you've had to do it. Whenever you have the exponent of something quadratic, you should think of completing the square. That's the standard way to evaluate an inhomogeneous quadratic form. Here we have a quadratic form, the field appears twice, but then here it appears linearly. So that's inhomogeneous. We want to make this a nice homogeneous quadratic form. So the next step is complete the square. We're going to define a new variable phi prime of x. It's just a shifted version of our variable phi of x, our function phi of x. Now, of course, I know the answer, so I'm just going to write it out. But you know, there will be situations where you won't know the answer. And I'll just show you how to guess the correct answer. So this shift here is just the analog of, in the many variable Gaussian integral case, of taking your variables x and shifting them by the inverse of the matrix in the exponent. So this here is no different from that, right? And it works because we've got that this is, this Feynman propagator here is really, this Green's function is really just the continuous version of the inverse of this operator here. So I think there's a minus sign. No, I didn't have a minus sign in here. So if you want to complete the square in one of these continuous path integral Gaussian thingies, then just remember what you would do with a many variable Gaussian, and then just mimic it by putting in the Green's function for your operator your differential operator delta squared minus m squared. Good, let's just substitute this new function phi prime of x into our exponent and we can see what happens. So we get four terms, right, when we substitute phi equals phi prime plus I d4y df blah, blah, blah. Four terms. The first term is easy. That's what I've written just there. And then we get two other terms which do something nice. There's one. Oh yeah, right, I've just cancelled it. So two terms cancel and we're just left with the new quadratic form and the bit that you have to cancel off whenever you do a complete the square operation. Look at this. This is looking pretty good. I guess I've got to put a box there, a bracket there, and there's an I missing. But otherwise, we're good. And then if we substitute that into our expression for the generating functional, well, then we're really in business now. So, oh yeah, right. I should mention the Jacobian for this transformation. You know, we're changing variables in an integral at the end. You have to talk about Jacobians. Well, it's equal to 1 because it's just a shift. Okay, so that's the only sort of subtlety that you should be. You might be worried about, you know, maybe the Jacobian is some strange function. Indeed, actually, later in the course, it's very tempting to do these kind of changes of variables, but you have to be real careful about the Jacobian. So the minute you do something that's not just a plain shift like this, then the Jacobian can be a very complex object indeed. Contain a lot of physics. Good, then, so the generating function becomes something very nice indeed. So we get two terms in the exponent. So these turn into a product when you substitute them in here. And one term is just a constant as far as the this integral here is concerned. What we get at the end. I have to name this z naught. And it's just this stuff. But there's a floating factor of I that I haven't accounted for here. The two I's cancel, thank you. Yeah, it's all good. All right, yeah, and Z naught, what is it? Well, it's some thing that depends on phi primes. It's just some number, but it doesn't depend on J. And of course, we never need Z naught when we do a calculation. Because we always divide by Z naught, right? We always divide by Z of J evaluated at J equals naught. So that term there will cancel off always, this Z naught, this rather distressing looking object here that could be infinite. Indeed it is, it's always infinite, this thing here. I'll be lazy, I'll just put it in there rather than write it out again. So this is like absolutely fantastic, right? We've completely evaluated this generating functional here, and we have this absolutely concrete, explicit expression for this object. It's a quadratic exponential of a quadratic function of these currents J, and using it and just the standard rules for functional differentiation, we can get any endpoint correlation function that we so desire. And yeah, okay, I'll actually do an example calculation of the four-point function using this observation. the exercise sheet, you're going to have to work very, very hard to get a four-point function from a path integral. You're going to discretize. You're going to have this 16 terms. You're going to look at which ones cancel, which ones don't. Keep track of all the edge cases, and eventually you'll get the right answer. And so if you encounter an exercise like that, you might be a little bit depressed, right? Well, you know, this path integral, it's so amazing, you know, it seems like I still have to do a lot of hard work. Well, you know, once you've seen this, and once you've done the hard work, then you're allowed to use this much nicer way of doing things. But you have to do the hard work first. There's no, you have to, you know, feel it. You have to get the intuition from doing these calculations explicitly with discretizations before, A, you can appreciate how good this is, and B, before you can trust this tool that we have here. Because, you know, at various points I did kind of naughty things, right? You know, I moved derivatives past integrals and various other naughty actions. They all fine as long as they match with the experiment at the end, but you have to gain that intuition for when things will be fine. But now we've done it, let's do a real calculation in anger of a four-point function. I'll just use a sort of simplified notation here. This is all for this Klein-Gordon theory. We're not doing interacting theories yet, although it's very straightforward to add in interactions now. So what are these phi 1 hats? Well, phi 1 hat just means phi evaluated at the point x1 and so on, just so that we don't have to write that stuff out all over. That's how to compute a four-point function. Let's get to it. We already have an expression for zj divided by z naught. So let's exploit that in the next line. So let's do the first functional derivative. See what we get. Well, okay, I'm starting to use a slightly simplified notation. I hope it doesn't need that much explaining. Dx4. X minus X4. And J subscript Y, I mean, J is Y. J of Y. Now we've got a functional derivative that can apply to this guy or to this guy. Oh, there's an integral here. That's what's weird. Yeah. So we get minus d3, 4. So the notation takes a little getting used to, but you'll see it in as you work through it slowly. You know, all we're doing here at each. We're just obeying the rules of differentiation. So we differentiate this quadratic exponent, bringing it down, and then we differentiate that with respect to the functional derivative. Yeah, question?
So there are two integrations in the exponent.
There's two over x and y, yeah.
So the x is not the same as before the integral. So the integration before the exponent is another x.
That's another x, yeah. Yeah, okay, x prime, let's say. Yeah, the integration here is a different integration to that one up here, is a different variable x prime. So we're just obeying the rules for differentiation. How do you differentiate an exponential? You bring down the exponent and then you differentiate the exponent. That's all we've done here in that step there. And that's just the original generating functional right there. That was step one. And then step two, we carry out the second functional derivative where we've got to differentiate this guy and then this guy. So we're gonna get the derivative of this guy first, which is this. And then we get the derivative of this guy, which is, you know, this thing times by the exponent. Dx and 3. No, there's a 3 here. So if you look at this, so let's look at this term here.
What is the J for 3?
Oh, that's a Y.
And what is the J Y?
Oh, yeah, that doesn't make any sense. Oh, yeah. What have I done?
J Y and then D Y3.
It's very possible it's a J Y. Where's my notes? I'll. Maybe I need to rewrite that line. What have I got here? Yeah, there we go. Jx, dx4, jy, dy3. Okay, let's rewrite this. I'm just going to work it out myself. So the first term, when we functionally differentiate this thing here, we get a delta function there giving us a d3, 4. That part is good. Then when we functionally differentiate this guy, we just bring down another factor of that. we're also left with the original factor, a 3. And this is all multiplied by our quadratic exponential of our quadratic guy, e minus 1/2 there. Yep, another question?
The
original factor contained, oh gosh. There, a 4. Yeah, the original factor contained a 4. That's the original one, say. Oh, I'm missing out the integral sign. But now I think everything is stable. Yeah. And now we can do this next derivative. So this thing here is now a constant as far as that derivative is concerned. So this guy just doesn't even see that. It only applies to this thing here, giving us 2 3s or 2 4s. Or it applies to the exponent and brings down another factor of this integral thingy here. Let's write that all out. Double check this. So, yeah, there's some minus factors I'm missing. Nope, that's good. That's good. That's good. Yeah. And I've I've explicitly neglected one particular term. There's actually an additional term I should have brought down. But because we know we're going to evaluate J as naught at the end, we're going to not even going to bother writing out that next term. So there's another term, which depends on J quadratically. But remember, we're going to evaluate at J is naught, so we don't bother writing out quadratic terms at this stage of the game. And we're done. So here, this quadratic term can't possibly give us a contribution to the final result. And when we do this last functional integral here, we don't even bother bringing down the exponent anymore because that'll be quadratically depending on j. And we also need not worry about, well, yeah, that's it. That's it. All these linear terms contribute, however. And that's where we get these three terms here. Boom. So in sort of like one board, we get the four-point function. So I'm pretty sure when you do your exercise, it'll take you a bit more space than that. You have to become a bit more comfortable with the notation, but you see how efficient this is as a tool for generating you lots of nice correlation functions. And I guess, yeah, okay, I'll say a comment about interactions, and then we're really finished, I think, with interacting scalar field theory with path integrals. How do we deal with interactions? Well, we deal with interactions the same way we always do, which is to say we just use a Taylor series. So, you know, we have to do this path integral here, I s naught plus I s int plus j phi. And there's this limit out the front. How might we actually deal with this expression? Well, you can use a Taylor series. In powers of lambda. And substitute this Taylor series into this expression here. Sorry, there's So this is a time-ordered product of field operators, or the endpoint function. This is the main observable of interacting quantum field theory. And we first use a Taylor series for the exponent, and then use the generating function. I won't say anything more about it because in the end you end up with the same Feynman rules that you would get from canonical quantum field theory, canonical quantization. So the generating function is just an extremely elegant tool to extract out the endpoint correlation functions of free theories. When you get to interactions, it's not as useful. Although there are certain approaches to dealing with quantum field theory that use the generating function, approximating it for the full interacting theory. Well, really won't have time to talk about that in this course, I think. Okay. You've seen how wonderful and useful the path integral is for bosons, for scalar fields. That's all great. but nature hands us more than one kind of particle. We've got bosons and fermions, and these Fermi fields, well, can we define path integrals for Fermi fields, and are they as useful? The answer is obviously yes. But we're going to have to think outside the box a little. What if psi is a Fermi field? Then you might hope that you can write something like this, that the time-ordered correlation function of the Fermi field at two different places is somehow the path integral of something classical. And this brings us to the question, you know, we're integrating over something classical, presumably, because that's how the path integral was introduced to us. But that kind of forces us to answer a question. What is a classical fermion? You know, what features of the fermions should persist to the classical limit? Well, it's kind of an interesting question. I would advise you not to think about this too physically. You know, avoid operationally interpreting this thing. So step, you know, rule one about dealing with this. Don't think about it operationally. Because in fact, the right-hand side is extraordinarily tricky to deal with operationally anyway. You're equating things in different categories altogether. Here you've got on the left-hand side, you've got quantum observables with quantum theories. These are perfectly operationally well-defined. I can describe to you the experiment that will estimate this quantity. And on the right-hand side, we've got this object that has is extremely questionable operationally, you know, summing over all classical paths. You can go down the route of trying to interpret that as literally as you want. I don't advise it. Well, at least don't do it in Hanover. Instead, you should think of this path integral as kind of like the complex numbers. So, you know, a complex number is like a mathematical phantasm, right? We don't see complex numbers in our everyday experience, but their presence kind of obtrudes themselves on lots of questions. You know, if you want to solve the equation x squared equals minus 1, you know, what times what equals minus 1? It's a question you can ask. Well, you know, one answer is nothing. But the other is, you know, why don't we introduce something that is a solution to that equation? Work with it. And then as long as we ask questions that don't involve that thing, then that may be a useful device to take shortcuts mathematically. So you can do a lot of all of the equations of physics, you could just refuse to ever introduce the complex number I and work with real numbers. It's actually possible. It gets sort of successively more tedious when you get to quantum mechanics, but it is possible to simulate complex quantum mechanics with real quantum mechanics. And indeed, every question we ask about quantum mechanics doesn't have the answer I in it, right? You know, if I ask you what's the expectation value or you know, how many clicks per second do I get from this photon counter, then you know I don't get the number I. So it's obviously it's something that's a useful shortcut in doing the derivations, but it doesn't exist at the beginning or the endpoints operationally. Now you should think about what we're going to define now is precisely in those terms. Don't think about it as something that exists as an object in the universe, right? You can't find a classical fermion field, just as you cannot find a classical field full stop. We live in a quantum universe, so classical fields already are questionable. So you should think of them as instead as this calculational shortcut that allows you to do cool tricks, just as complex numbers allow you to do cool tricks. You know, some integrals, they're a real pain to do, but if you use complex contour integrals, they're like, phew, done in seconds. So this is exactly how you should think of the things I'm about to define. And the property we want to focus on is this. We want to understand the exclusion principle for a classical thing. And also, we note that this is also true, right? So we're going to build something, a classical object, that has these two properties, that if you square it, you get zero, and if you multiply it by another one of these guys, then it exchanges and gives you a minus sign. So this is the classical limit of a fermion. We're going to build these objects up from basic linear algebra. It'll give us some it'll give us some objects like the complex numbers that are useful for doing calculations. Very useful. Brings us to the topic of anti-commuting numbers or Grassmann variables. So for now, forget that we're in a physics class. You've just entered into a linear algebra classroom, so you don't have to, I'm not going to attach operational meaning to anything I'm saying. We're just going to invent some mathematical objects and some rules that they obey. All right, let V be n-dimensional vector space, and let these theta A's be just n basis vectors for our vector space. That means that every element of our vector space is a linear combination of these guys. Hope you remember your linear algebra. And what we're going to do is we're going to build a bigger vector space using V. And this bigger vector space will be our anti-commuting numbers or Grassmann variables. And as many constructions in mathematics work this way, you know, you ask, what's the object that has the properties that I want, but no other properties. So the properties that I want is that I can take two of these elements, theta, and kind of multiply them. So I should have a way to multiply two elements. And this multiplication rule should obey the rule that if I multiply an element by itself, I get zero. And if I multiply two different elements, then they're equal to minus the product in the opposite order. So these are relations. There's two things I wrote at the top of the board. And the thetas are the generators. So this is such a common device in maths. It comes under many names. You define a space by freely generating something by a bunch of relations. That's what we say in maths. So the bits of data that we want is we want a kind of product we're going to build a space from these thetas by saying, well, first of all, we want to at least be able to multiply thetas. Remember, we have a vector space. There's no notion of multiplying two vectors. When you have a vector space, you have to introduce that as an extra structure. So we denote multiplication just by concatenation, right? You just add the symbols one after the other. And this and extend that operation by linearity. So if we stopped here, we'd have a space, let's call it S of V. We'd end up with a space, let's call it S infinity of V, which is just the linear span of concatenations of these symbols. The A's, and then we have A, B's. We have A, B, C, forever. This would be an infinite dimensional vector space. So if you just introduce a product operation on a vector space, you instantly end up with an infinite dimensional vector space. Because you haven't demanded anything more from your product operation other than it's a product operation. So we're building what's known as a monoid here. We don't yet have an identity. We don't even have a multiplicative identity here. We just have that we can, so it's not even a monoid, I guess it's a, I forget the name of this thing, semi-group without identity, whatever. So we have some, well, it's an algebra, that it is. So you have some vector space, and you've introduced, with no other relations, this product operation on this space, S infinity of V. But we want this product to obey some relations. We have this prejudice that a classical fermion field should obey psi squared is zero, and it should anti-commute at different places. And that those relations are, we can impose those relations via the following. So here's the relations that phi squared, which is just theta squared, which is otherwise known as theta A, Whenever you encounter that, you define that to be equivalent to zero. Or another way of saying that is that this equation and also that theta A equals minus theta B theta A. And another way of writing that equation is that theta A theta B plus theta B theta A equals zero. Yep. The first one already follows from the second one. That's absolutely right. For all, yeah, but it does if I say this, right? But actually, indeed, you're correct. There's no point in having written that down, but I write that down for emphasis. And if you take your infinite dimensional vector space that you defined here, and you impose these relations, this is a freely generated symmetric algebra, I guess. No, just the free algebra on V. And you impose these relations, then you build a vector space G of V, which is no longer infinite dimensional. It's in fact 2 to the n dimensional. And that's a nice little exercise for you to ponder. I'll write out the actual statement. The dimension of this new vector space when you've imposed these equivalence relations is 2 to the n. And I'll write out a basis for this vector space. And then I leave that. And then I'll leave you with the joyful task of checking that everything's well defined. And that indeed it's a vector space. If you know about differential forms, this is exactly the space of differential forms. When your vector space is the tangent space. Which is why people talk about differential forms as classical fermions. You'll see that occasionally. So, check everything I said is well defined. That just means if I have two elements and they are equivalent, that under this equivalence relation, all the operations respect the equivalence relation. Slightly tedious exercise, but not very complicated. We have an actual basis for this space. We have the number 1, that's an element of our original vector space. And we have we adjoin this actually. Sorry. We adjoin an identity element, we'll do that in a minute. But the basis that we actually get is phi A for A equals 1 to n. And then you get, theta A theta B for A is less than B. You know, why have I got this constraint here? Well, if I had theta B theta A, then I could just use that relation up there to rewrite it as theta B theta A with a minus sign. and so on, right? So a general element of our space, G of V, is a linear combination of these basis vectors here. There's 2 to the n basis vectors. Where each of these alphas are some complex numbers. Yeah, this is what I meant by adjoin this element here. So we add another element, this identity element. So when you do that, you get, well, that's what I should have done. All right, so this is a complex vector space and we have an explicit basis. So at the moment, I'll just stop. And this vector space is an algebra, meaning that you can multiply two things and get something. That multiplication operation works in this space. So at the moment, this is just some mathematical thing that I decided for crazy reasons to invent. In the coming lecture, next week, we're going to see how this crazy mathematical object will allow us to do calculations that look very much like the Gaussian integrals that we did for boson fields. That, I think, is a story for another lecture. And so today I stop there. Thank you very much. Yeah, 2 questions, yes?
I think you have to make this just less than and not equal or less.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There's 1 bug here, yes. This is strictly less than, not less than equals.